New Yorkers love oysters. That's a well-known fact. But what isn't so well-known is that New York City was once considered the oyster capital of the world. But that was then. Today, oysters are functionally extinct in New York Harbor. What happened? Why does it matter? And what can we do about it? Well, one project that was created to do something about it is the Billion Oyster Project, which, among other things, enlists thousands of area school children in its efforts to restore the city's oyster population. And joining us now to talk about that, and as part of our Peril and Promise initiative on the human impact of climate change, we're now joined by Peter Malinowski, Executive Director of the Billion Oyster Project, and Sally McGee, Northeast Marine Program Director at the Nature Conservancy, which has partnered with the Billion Oyster Project. Welcome, both of you.
Thanks for having me.
So, Peter, let me start with you. What is the history of oysters in New York City? Were we really that thick in oysters back in the day?
Well, originally, when Europeans first arrived, there was over 200,000 acres of oyster reef just in New York Harbor. Some estimated that it was half the world's oysters. And more importantly, with that many oysters, those oysters supported a really vast and diverse ecosystem. So when Europeans first arrived, they could catch fish just by lowering a basket over the side of the boat and bringing it back up full of fish. So that, you know, oysters are known as a keystone species, which they filter the water, provide habitat for other animals, stabilize the shore, protect the shore from waves. And so, you know, in that way, they engineered a whole ecosystem that, you know, filled the harbor before we ate them all.
So what happened? How did they become functionally extinct?
Well, in only about 100 years after colonization, we had eaten all the oysters. So it was a huge business, you know, hundreds of ships, and we were dredging oysters all over the harbor. And so by the early or mid-1800s, all the wild oysters had been fished out. And then New Yorkers started importing seed oysters from Chesapeake Bay and Delaware Bays, bringing them up in seeding beds in the harbor. And that worked until the completion of the Croton Aqueduct. Mm-hmm. And then New Yorkers had as much fresh water as they wanted, and so they took as many showers and flushed as many toilets and washed as many dishes, and it all went out into the harbor and onto the oyster beds. Came as a big surprise to New Yorkers that pouring raw sewage on your food supply was a problem. Yeah. People started getting sick, and then in the early 1900s, they closed the last of the oyster beds.
Yeah. Give us the detailed reasons why an oyster population here in New York or anywhere is important.
You know, first is that we want to give people in New York the ability to get out and enjoy the water more. And if the water and the ecosystem is healthier, then they're going to be able to do that more so. Another reason is, like Pete said, oysters, they're wonderful water quality filters. So, you know, a single oyster, a single adult oyster can filter for 50 gallons of water in one day. So if we get a billion of them.
Filters what? What does it filter?
Well, it eats phytoplankton. You know, and in a condition like the water is in New York Harbor, there's too much of that, so you have oysters in the water, and that improves the water quality.
And oyster reefs, how much did they help, you know, for example, when we have a hurricane and the waters are coming onto the island?
Mm-hmm. They do help. They definitely do. I mean, that's one of the benefits of shellfish reef restoration, is that they provide a buffer from storm surge and waves.
So tell us about the project.
Well, what we're trying to do is to restore a sustainable oyster population to New York Harbor, and through that work, change the relationship that New Yorkers have to the natural resource. And we believe that active engagement in a restoration project is a really powerful way to build enthusiasm and excitement and your knowledge of that resource, right? You can't restore oysters if you don't know how to drive boats, if you don't know how to scuba dive, grow oysters, and actually get in the water and do that work. And so we work with about 100 public schools throughout all five boroughs, where we teach math and science teachers to teach their lessons through the lens of oyster restoration and get their students out on the water's edge, pulling up cages of oysters, understanding, you know, what exists on the other side of the land of the air-water barrier, seeing that there's animals in the water, understanding tides and currents and storms and everything that goes along with that.
So you want to establish a culture of stewardship among kids. What about the rest of us who don't know anything about it?
Well, that's one of our, you know, we have no chance of restoring a billion oysters if we're not able to engage as many of the 8 million people who live here as possible.
Okay.
So we also collect shells from restaurants, so people who like eating oysters can participate in the project just by eating farmed oysters and recycling their shells. We have volunteer programs on the island where you can come out and be a volunteer. You can be a member of Billion Oyster Project and participate that way.
So, Sally, the Nature Conservancy does other things besides partnering with the Billion Oyster Project.
Yeah, we do. We have We have an exciting new project that's been in the works for about a year now that we just started working with shellfish farmers. So these are the people who grow the oysters that end up on your plate as a oyster on the half shell at happy hour. So we're working with a group of shellfish farmers who actually came to us really concerned about the impacts that they were seeing about of climate change on their farms. So they wanted to do something about it. They're seeing these impacts and didn't really have the means to do that. So they approached the Nature Conservancy and said, you know, we're really concerned about the changing water chemistry that's happening, the increased frequency and intensity of storms. You know, what can we do? And so we've created what we're calling the Shellfish Growers Climate Coalition. That is a group of shellfish growers on the East and West Coast, and it's growing every day.
Oh, okay, Peter. Thank you so much, and thank you, Sally, for joining us today. This is a really interesting topic, right, and important one.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for having me.